chapter 6, verse 1 to 8, very quickly. Isaiah 6, 1 to 8, verse 1 now. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Every time God shows up, there is a paraphernalia that follows him. Glory, majesty, honor, it filled the temple. Verse 2, above it stood the seraphim. That's above the throne now. Each one had six wings. With two, he covered his face. With two, he covered his feet. With two, he did fly. So there were six, two covered the feet, two the face, and then two flew. Why did he cover his face? Even the angels, as holy as they are not fit to look into God's face. Come on. Hello? Hello? Even the angels, as pure as they are not fit to see God. So God gave them privilege with his presence, so they had to cover their faces with their wings. So what a privilege it is for man that you can walk into God's presence and see him. In a ceremony. That's why the angel said, what is man that thou art mindful of him? The son of man that thou visit, how can you visit man? The angel don't understand that man is greater than angels. Man was made in the image of God. Angels was made in the image of beasts. Forgive me. That's why they have wings. We don't have wings. Amen? Are you following what I'm saying? And angels were created to serve us. They are ministering spirit to serve. We command them. They are our bodyguard, they are our steward, they are tenant, they are our messengers. We command them and they go. And they are not angry. They understand that that's their creation. Amen? The angels cannot have the divine nature, but we have the divine nature. Are you following what I'm saying, somebody? So the angels cover their faces with wings. And number three now, one cried unto another and said, holy, 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 he's too holy for me to see him. He's thrice holy. He's the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of his works. Then verse 4, one to go, and the post of the door moved at the voice of him. Angel cried, doors shook. The voice of angels uprooted the post of that door. The windows vibrated. Boom, angels shouting. Doors are breaking open. How much more in God's things? The doors move at the voice of him that, and all of these things are happening, and Isaiah is seeing everything. He saw the Lord. The angels could not see the Lord. He saw all the manifestation. The angels could not see. The house was filled with what? Smoke, which is tradition for the glory of God when he shows up. Verse 5, then said I, when he beheld what has happened, he said, oh, this is not a joke. Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. His nakedness appeared. You can't see God and not see your fault. You can't see God and not see your shortcomings. You can't see God and still brag about your status. Once you see God, the first thing is to see yourself in the light of that revelation and then amend your ways. Woe is me, for I'm undone because I'm not from cleanness and I dwell in the midst of a people of cleanness, for my eyes now have seen who? The king. Not a king, the Lord of what? Hosts. Now who are the hosts? The angels, he saw. Now look at verse 6. Then flew, as soon as the angels noticed that the man has found his shortcoming and is going to expose him to the brightness of God's presence for death, because we can't see God with sin and not die. Sin reacts chemically in the presence of God. Not physically. Physically, reaction is the one that can proceed forward and backward without consequences. Can we go yesterday when I proceed forward and never goes backward? That if I burn paper now, I can't get the paper. Yes or no? That's chemical reaction. If I put water in the freezer, I can become black. If I bring it out, I become water again. That's reversible reaction. Are you following what I'm saying now? Now, chemical reaction is the one that is permanent. If you burn firewood, the only thing you get is called ash. And that ash can never be firewood. That's chemical. When a man with sin encounters the brightness of God's glory, he becomes ash. He cannot become man again. That's what caused death. That's what killed Ananias and Sapphira. Why has Satan filled your heart to tear this life in the presence of the Holy Ghost? When he heard in the presence, boom, he fell down and he died. You can't hear that and live. The fullness of the Shekinah does not allow human imperfection. Are you in the house of God, somebody? Can we enjoy God's presence tonight? Because I want someone to go home this night and as if a wind, a curtain opens and then they lead you into an inner chamber. And then you're looking at the face of God. And you come back a different person. Somebody here will see him. Somebody here will see him. This night, this week, somebody here will see him. Say amen, somebody. There is something that happens to you and life changes forever. May it happen this night. So the man, when the angel saw it, the angel quickly had to remedy him. Flew quickly with something that looks like interception of the blood of Jesus. He flew unto him, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken from the tongue, with the tongue, from off the altar, verse 7, and he laid it on his mouth and said, "Lo, keep quiet. This hath touched thy lips, and thy iniquity is what? Taken away. And I see. But why? Because God is more interested in your God encounter than you are. So he will do anything to clear up and all the gold of all your obstacles so you can access it. This has touched him, and thy sins are purged, so you can have now access into his presence. Then the Bible says in verse 8, also I heard a voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then said I, here am I, send me. My message is simple. The God encounter. The God encounter. The God encounter. And I pray that you hear me well this night. I pray you hear me well. Because it will happen to somebody. Nothing changes lives like divine encounter. Nothing changes times like divine encounter. Nothing changes seasons like divine encounter. One encounter can change your times, change your seasons, change your life forever. There can be no genuine destiny transformation in the absence of divine encounter. Every transformation begins with what? A God encounter, a divine encounter. Life can change, ministry can change, business can change, career can change. Relationship can change. Marriage can change. Everything about your life will remain as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Have you heard that one before? Yes, it will remain like that until there is an encounter. Friends, your God encounter changes everything. Everything. It makes all the difference in your life. Now, it turns a failure into a mega success. When you encounter God once, it turns a failure into what? A mega success. And it turns a dummy into a genius. You know what it is called, a genius? Excellent at his best. He turns a dummy into a genius. He turns insecurity into superhero and superstar. It turns dwarf into giants. One encounter. It turns weaklings into super warriors. It turns paupers into millionaires and men of financial strides. All you need for a mega change is what? One encounter. Need to ask him, Father. I need an encounter. Even Jesus, the Son of God, was not exempted. Was not exempted. Was not exempted. 30 years without that encounter, he was the son of the carpenter. But when the heavens opened and the dove appeared, and this is my beloved son, you know, from that time, boom, the real Messiah was born that day. The one that Mary gave birth to was a mere mortal. Amen. 40 days from there, everyone knew that a champion was arrived. His fame went abroad. Why? One encounter. Even the Son of God couldn't escape the compliance with the law of encounters for manifestation. Are you there, someone? What then is God encounter? What is God encounter? Number one, a face-to-face meeting with God that changes your entire life forever. A face-to-face meeting with God that changes your entire life forever. A face-to-face meeting with God that changes your entire life forever. Now listen, you have heard that no man had ever seen God at any time. Yes, true, true. We have not seen God, but we have seen God in the form of Jesus, in the form of the Holy Ghost. But the Father we cannot see, because he's too holy for us to see. But the Father steps down his transformer in Jesus and appears to us. He stepped down like a transformer in the Holy Ghost and appears to us, so we can have a face-to-face encounter. When Abraham saw three men came to him to talk to him, it was the Father who came, but he came in the triumphant revelation of his Son. Are you following me, somebody? So we can see. And Jesus said, if you have seen me, you have seen my Father. Am I right? I and my Father are what? Are one. So people can argue, you cannot see God and live. Not true. But God can has made a way for us to see him through his Son and through his Spirit. So there's a face-to-face meeting with God that changes your entire life forever. Number two is an unexpected meeting with God that leaves tremendous positive impact on your life and destiny. An unexpected meeting with God that leaves tremendous positive impact in your life and destiny. Tremendous positive, not negative. God can't meet you and the subsequent reaction become negative. It's always a crescendo, rising to higher heights, higher dimension of manifestation. Number three, what is God encounter? It is a life-transforming experience between man and God that answers all your questions and changes the course of your existence. A life-transforming experience between God and man, or man and God, that answers all your questions. There are questions in your heart to ask that when you see God without him talking, the answers are given. By just you meeting him and getting up, all your answers are what? You can meet God without him talking. Inside you, he download like a therapist, a microchip, all your worries, all your, you just get, you get to a place where you know, sometimes I know. You just know what was the mahala. All of your troubles are solved. The questions are answered. The problems are clear. And you just get up and you are, do you hear what I'm saying? Number one now. You don't get my story very well. Okay? I said a life transforming experience between man and God that answers all your questions and changes the course of your existence. The course, the route of your existence. Number four, a significant experience with God that leaves an unforgettable memory with you for life. Significant experience with God that leaves an unforgettable memory. When God truly appears to you, nobody can delete it from your medulla oblongata. If you dream and you forget it, and you are trying to remember it, it's inconsequential. But if it came from God for destiny, you can't make Joseph forget the two dreams he had. You can't. It will stick. If God
a memorial
on your medulla. It stays there. You got that, isn't it? A significant experience with God that leaves an unforgettable memory with you for how long? For life. The memory stays there for life. Isaiah will still tell us in heaven, this thing he wrote here, he's still in his head, he's still there. Ezekiel will still tell us, Ezekiel 1 verse 1, won't get it, and he will describe, Daniel will describe the face of eagle, the face of tiger, the face of lion, that beast is on. He will describe it because it's there. When God gives you an encounter, Satan cannot delete it. Number one now. I give the fifth one that I run for time's sake. Divine appearance and visitation that becomes a reference point of your turning point. Now, this is important now. Divine appearance and visitation that becomes the reference point of your turning point. You had a turning point, but there's something that is a reference point to that your turning point. Every time you remember your turning point, you remember the reference point. That encounter is the reference point that brought about the turning point. From that time on, my life was not the same. From that moment forward, my story changed. From that hour on, my chicken-heartedness was substituted for a lion heart. So it is divine appearance and visitation that becomes the reference point of your turning point. Turning point has a reference point. When did it happen? It happened when this and this happened. When I met with God and he said this to me, and I took a hold on that word and ran with it from that time to eternity. That encounter sponsors the turning point. It becomes a reference point of that turning point. Are you in the Holy Ghost, somebody? No. Encounters can be physical and visible. Number one. Different kinds of encounter. How encounters come and how they can be. It can be one, physical and visible. You can have a physical and visible encounter. Number two, in fact, before number two, Genesis 18, 1 to 3, we find out that Abraham had a physical encounter. Three men walked to his house. One of them was God. Two of them were angels. And I shared something with us some weeks or months ago. I think a year ago so. Amen? That was the day that God came to replace Adam. Hello? How many of us were aware of that? There were three archangels in heaven. One of them was the most powerful and most important because he was responsible for worship, some of the worship. His name is called Lucifer. Say amen, somebody. Yeah. And he was so important because he gave God what God loves the most. And he was created for that purpose. The second one was the one who was in charge of the military warfare. His name is called Michael. The third one, the one that carries messages from God to humanity and anywhere he dispatches, is called the PRO of heaven. His name is called Gabriel. Those are the three angels you really know. They are archangels. But then, the most important one got so close to God that he fell. Lucifer fell. So God was looking for someone to replace Lucifer. And he tried and tried and tried, couldn't find anyone. So he wanted to rubbish Lucifer for life. He knelt on the mud and back mud, molded mud to look like himself. He blew into mud. Mud became a man. And God said, replace Lucifer. That's why God said the reason we live is to what? To worship. Because Lucifer lived to worship him. We were created a substitute for him, but we were created in a deeper koinonia with God. Even say that's why Satan hates us. Why do you think Satan fights humanity? Why is he after Job? Why is he after Terry? Why is he after Lucifer? Because Satan knows we are his substitute. The closer you are to God, the more attacks you saw from Satan. Because he sees you as a rival. The one who is making God ignore. Who you are trying to heal God of the wound of his loss. Are you following what I'm saying? That's why he said, woe to man.
Satan is cast down to the earth, having what? Great wrath. And then he told her what to do. Resist him how? Stand whatever you bind on earth. Bind him. Don't play with Satan. He's not your friend. He can offer you things after he's trying to substitute. When Jesus came, what did Satan mean? He came and said, come, if you know me, come, turn this stone to bread. He wanted to also swindle him. He's envious of your position. He hates it. He doesn't like you when you get closer to God. That's why it looks difficult to go to church consistently. That's why it's a battle to be able to pray every single day for 1 hour. Sometimes you go there, it looks as if everywhere is dry. Nothing is happening. You try to sing a song, your voice look like Lucifer lives inside your throat. Have you ever been there before? It's not that God is not there. Satan is the one trying to come off and block your access. So God says, enter his gate with what? Once you thank him enough, Lucifer clears. Because why does it clear? Because God comes to inhabit the praises. When God comes, Satan goes. When God comes, Satan goes. And you follow what I'm saying now? So Satan was created a worshiper and he missed it. That encounter there was after Adam fell and was no one to redeem Adam, replace Adam. God started looking for replacement. Look for them in different people. Found first Abel, Cain killed Abel. Who killed Abel? Cain. Who killed him? Satan. True. Satan knows that God started what flowing towards him there. Since the father has fallen, Satan came. Step by step, anyone that goes after God, Satan has a problem with you. Not that he can kill you, he only kills you by your carelessness, your dumbness, your lack of talking, your lack of expression of who you are. Behold, I give unto you what? To do what? You keep quiet. What happens to you? From the days of John Baptist, now the kingdom of God. So the Bible does what? Anyone who knows who he is, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the words of their word. And he says, above all, taking the sword of the spirit or taking the shield of faith, wherewith you will be able to quench. Hey, there's nothing Satan fires that faith cannot handle. So there are all manner of things in the Bible to help you deal with Satan, put him summarily under arrest. So Adam fell. What's the name now? Abel fell. Then God started looking for men. God looked for men till he found Noah. Noah now fell. Drunk wine and became naked and talked nonsense and caused his son. And then from that time, while I began, God is still looking for a replacement. God picked one. He found one. His name was Enoch. That one became too close to God. God said, I can't leave this man on this earth. Come, let's go. So after Enoch went, nobody was there for God. God kept looking for until one day God found Abraham's father, told him, go to Canaan. The man started a journey. And what happened to others happened to Israel. He came to a place and saw little prosperity, little rest, and then he said, let's settle here. He died. God told Abraham, do you know I told your father to go somewhere? He said, yes. He said, are you willing to go now? Let's go. Abraham obeyed. Abraham followed. When God watched Abraham's life consistently and saw the dedication of humility and obedience, when God saw that he was the right person, God said, he is now the kind of man. Can I do anything without telling Abraham? For I know him. He raised his son that time. Have to follow me. Nah, let's go. So God came with Michael. Don't ask me what you want. Okay? When you meet him, he'll tell you. But just know, those three men that came was the warrior angel, Michael, archangel, and the messenger angel. What's his name now? And then God the Father. They came for the initiation ceremony of bringing Abraham into the order of the replacement. And they did it by having communion in Abraham's house. God ate without going to the toilet. Where did the food go to? The angels ate, they chewed meat, they broke the bone. They ate it. Angels, where? did you put it? God is a spirit.
Where did God hit the food into? That's the question I will ask the Father when I meet him in heaven. That food you ate in heaven, where did it go to? But the book says they ate. And after they ate, they now said, can I now, since you entered into the this deep koinonia with us, you are now a third, a fourth party in this hierarchy meeting. Now let me tell you what I was going to do. I'm going to go and destroy Sodom. And listen, Abraham had no right to argue with God unless he was updated into this class. And God listened. And he argued that Abraham could have gone to fight them. God didn't get, but it was of his own fear that kept him. There is relationship that brings you to a place where you can ask what no man can ask. He descended bodily. So God appears to us sometimes physically and visibly. Let me run. My time is up. Running fast. Number two, through audible voice encounter. Acts 9:3-7. The encounter of Paul with Jesus on the way to Damascus was not a physical encounter. What he saw was the appearance of God that was too bright for him to handle as a sinner, so he blinded him. You see now why the angels cover their eyes? To cover him from being blinded. The brightness of his appearing blinded Paul, and Paul couldn't see. The Bible says, all they that stood with Paul, when they stood there speechless, only hearing the voice, but not seeing the man. It's too holy for your eyes to be able to see. He blinds. And if not that God sent a man to Saul Paul and say, open his eyes and scale fair, he will remain blind for life. Permanent damage. I said, encounters change. Did you hear that? Number next. Dream encounter. Dream. You can meet him by way of dream. Joseph in Genesis 37:6-7 met him. It changed his life forever. Then number four, you can meet him by way of trance. The difference between dream and trance is in dream, you're fully asleep. In trance, you are still hearing what people are saying. You're not lying there, you're not sleeping. But suddenly, you begin to see things or hear things outside this world. That's what trance. And then you say, what happened? Did you hear what I heard just now? Did you see what I said just now? You are asking people around you because you knew they were there and you knew you were hearing all their voices, but now just got caught up from among all of us and suddenly the trance is not usually too long. Trance is like you are in between the spirit and the world. It's like a wave, but something real is deposited on your hand, bam, like a stamp. In Acts chapter 10, we found Peter fell into a trance. There are other instances. Acts 10:10-15. That was the trance that turned the gospel towards the Gentiles. The Gentiles were not supposed to hear the gospel. I was not supposed to be a pastor. It was God. God knew the only way to make it happen was to go to Peter and give him an encounter. That trance, something came like a sheep. He saw all manner of bad beasts. Should eat. God now told him in a trance, Peter, arise, kill and eat. He said, hey, Lord, you know you're still treating me. I can't eat any of you. God said, what God has cleaned, no man should call unclean. That means the blood of Jesus has cleansed the Gentiles. Don't call them anymore unclean. Carry the gospel to them. Peter still didn't understand until not too long. As now the trance finished, two men bang at the gate. By Cornelius, he said he should come to you. That God appeared to him. First question: God Almighty appeared to an Italian, a mafia. God, by the description of what Peter had, Peter knew God appeared to Cornelius. Peter said, now I know what the dream means. What God has screamed, I should go. Let us go. He saddled their ass and boom. Went on some days' journey. When they got there,
And they started prophesying, Peter,
oh, Gentiles.
Then he started saying, now I know that God is no respecter of, but in any city, everyone that calls for him is accepted. He took an encounter to bring about some revolution for us to hear the gospel. Do you hear what I'm saying? Encounters always come when God is about to give man a shift. Hallelujah. Are you in the house of God today?
Yeah.
Number one, next is open vision. Open vision. Open vision. After the trance level, open vision. You find that in Ezekiel 1 verse 1, I was by the river Cheba, and suddenly the heavens opened, and I saw visions of God. I saw visions of God. So, apart from just trance, there is a one called vision, where you are sitting like this, you are not sleeping, or you are standing like this. Vision. Some say vision. Some say vision. There's one called inner voice of the spirit. You encounter God by the inner voice of the spirit. While you're sitting down there, as I'm talking now, you can be hearing another voice talking to you. What makes ministry, I'm saying, sweet, is not just the voice of the pastor. It's the voice that you hear behind the voice of the pastor that adds to what you're writing more than what the pastor is saying. That's the voice of the spirit. It affects your life, transforms your life. It adds to you. If I ask why, that's why if I collect all of our notebooks now, we're not writing the same thing. That's, he's speaking to you based on your need and necessities now. Are you following what I'm saying? God can talk to 5,000 people and they are all hearing different things at the same time. By his spirit, he knows your need. So he meets you at the point of your need. Say, I hear you now. By the inward voice. That's number one now. Number six, right? Number seven is divine idea that bears a mental shift and experience. Or mental experience and shift. Do you know that ideas are the voice of God? Do you know that ideas are encounters? What brought about Facebook? An idea. What brought about WhatsApp? An idea. What brought about Instagram? An idea. What brought about Twitter? An idea. What brought about Zoom? An idea. Whatever is carrying weight in the world came as an idea. And that idea was imparted by God in an encounter. You don't know, you don't know. It's an idea that will make, it's an escape route out of your trouble, out of lack, out of shame. An idea. God drops it as an encounter. Why you are just playing and playing and playing? It's your head. Why don't you mix this? Why don't you meet this person? What if you start this thing? That's the, it's an encounter. Encounters bring about turning point. Turning point. Now go ahead. Next one is, now the ideas that best mental shift and experience happens through different means. One, through the Bible, your Bible study. When you study the Bible, God gives you ideas from Bible study. When you get back home, you can read Luke 4, 17 to 20. That's how Jesus stumbled on the Spirit of the Lord upon me. He had anointed me to preach the gospel. That's where he took off from. That idea that came from Scripture became the pivot of his destiny. Next. It can come through spiritual books. That's inspirational books. Daniel 9, 1 and 2. I understood by books. I understood by books. If you don't read your Bible, you can't have this mental shift. God interacting with your mentality and changing things. If you don't read books, you can also have it. Ideas come from the volume of information. Number next is through CDs and DVDs of great men, of great mentors. Then, number seven, is this seven or eight? What I just said now was breaking down number seven. I said ideas, bad mental shift and experience, and they come through your Bible study, and they come through your study of spiritual books, and they come through your CDs and DVDs, right? Then I'm saying next one is through human encounters. God encounters you through human beings. God can use a man and encounter you, a prophet, and encounter you, a pastor, and encounter you, a mentor, and encounter you, a destiny helper,
and encounter you. God can use an unknown human agent to change and transform your life. Everyone that meets you, some of them may be sent by God and you're not aware. That's why God said, be careful how you treat people. You don't know who was sent to take you higher. Say it loud again, somebody. In 1 Samuel 10 verse 1, the pouring of oil on the head of Saul turned a poor man to a king. In 1 Samuel chapter 16 verse 13 and 14, the pouring of the oil upon the head of David turned a bush boy to a king, a palace boy. Are you following what I'm saying now? One man, and in 2 Kings 2:15, we'll be reading it again and again. Everyone came and saw him and bowed to him, and they said, the spirit of Elijah doth rest on who? It takes a man to make a man in God's agenda. He sends a man to make you. He sends a man to make you. Surrender yourself to a pastor, to a prophet, to a mentor, to a helper, to somebody. Don't be arrogant. Don't be puffed up. You will miss out on blessings. Amen. Sometimes the man that God will send to change your story will look very rickety, very, very unlike someone you want to meet with. And if you're the kind that don't know how to relate with people, you can now just push away your blessing. And he walks away. You don't go to school. There are certain dimensions of encounter you will never have. Write that down. Write that down. Write that down. You refuse to go to school when your parents pay school fees and you join the cult and run around the place in the bush and you came back with nothing. There are certain dimensions of encounters you can never have. Education is an encounter. Sir, you can't be a president, number one. Two, you can't be a governor. You can't be a commissioner. If you didn't finish secondary school, you cannot be. There are certain encounters you can have without certain dimensions of education. So the person of your parents is to help you appreciate books. They give you Bible quotations. You think they are punishing you. It's encounter. Then you trust your quoting will become a God inside you. The Word was made flesh and dwell where? Come on, talk to me now. And dwell where? You were memorizing it, but it became flesh and it dwelt among us. And we beheld the glory. It's the content of the Word in you that becomes the glory of your manifestation. You don't manifest beyond the dimension of word in you. So the word at that person is the word. That's how you cannot jump it. You can't cross it. It's just like passing primary one. If that one is easy, because they can pity you and cross you, give you two promotions from primary 3 to primary 5. Or primary 5 straight to secondary school. But in the school of the spirit, you don't cross it. You must appreciate human entities to qualify for word revelation. The word, man will teach you the word. And by what they teach you, you start hearing God's voice from the word by yourself. The very first voice of God Samuel heard was the voice of Eli. So when God calls you first from scripture, he uses the voice of your mentor. You don't know his voice, don't respect his voice. You will tell him, shut up, why are you disturbing me? You lose out from God's encounter. Say that somebody. Am I wasting your time? Are you hearing at all? Is anybody getting anything from what I'm sharing now? That's how things work. Bam, persons. Then bam, war, DVD, encounters. Then from there, you graduate from there to what I call the inner voice. Apart from hearing the word of God and having rhema encounter from the word, where the word makes sense and the word jumps out and the word fires up and the word becomes a vision in a vision, then there are other ones called the voice. The Holy Ghost can now take the word you have studied before and start talking to you. You will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way, do what? Walk down in it. It's an encounter. In one voice from the Spirit. When you graduate from persons, you enter into the word. From the word, you enter into the Holy Ghost voice. And then from there, you enter into dreams. Why Holy Ghost first? Because children hear the voice of God. Children hear his voice. Then bam, dreams. And from dreams, you graduate to trance. And there are people who have grown and grown and grown, and they stop at dream. And all they did was die there. Drunk, dream, 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 dream. God wants you to go up. Some say more. Say more. Say I want more. Say I need more. God wants you to grow up. Really, just brought you there so you can aspire for more. The next dimension is now trance. Where you're beyond dream, you're not sleeping for. You can catch it. You can get it. Then as you cross from trance, you enter what we call open vision. This is how God graduates us from person down to the world, DVD and other materials, then down to the voice of the Spirit inside you. Then you move on now to dreams, and then you go from there now to trance, and from trance you move up to a place called open vision, where your eyes are open, and you are, all of us are here, but you are seeing what nobody is seeing, and you are hearing what, and you can write them down. They are not aware. I want to write it down. Then when you grow from the place called open vision, you qualify for audible voice. Because if you don't know how to master vision, when you hear voice, you can run mad. Hello? You call it hallucination. I hear people talk to me. What have I done? Leave me alone, so I can have peace. You won't know it's God. But through visions and through trance, you can know the voice calling you now and talking to you. You grow from visions, you get to audible voice. Why? When you start hearing a man's voice, his personal presence is around the corner. Oh no, these people don't want that. You can hear that voice, it means it came from somebody in your realm, in your sphere, around you. That voice is to help you aspire for physical appearance and intimacy. Why am I only hearing your voice? Please show me your glory. That was what Moses said that took him up the mountain. I'm heard of you by the hearing of the ear. Now my eyes see and hear. That's what Job found. Don't be satisfied with just hearing his voice. Hearing his voice. There is a person behind the voice. There is no voice without a person. Therefore, if you can hear the voice, blessed are thou amongst men, amongst women. Now press for a higher encounter. Lord, show me your glory. Show me your glory. When Moses Christ said, oh, Moses, nobody has ever, even Abraham never, ain't nobody, Moses, this boy, how did you understand the secret? He said, but wait, there is a place by me. I will hide you in the cleft of the rock. I will cover your face. You will not see my face, so, because you will die in something. But when I pass, I will take my hands off your eyes, and you will see my backpack, for my face no man can see. But the truth was, the thing is, no man should even see God and live. But God now reduces it to his side. Father, stand. Turn, physical. You can see somebody. Have you ever seen somebody's back and you think it was somebody you knew? And you ran the person and you got and talk as a friend. The person told me, oh, saw you. Has that happened to you before?
Yes.
No, I thought it was my brother. Oh my, I'm sorry. Especially if you're a lady. It will make you look as if you're a chief. You understand me? So you have to apologize with him. I'm so sorry. You look exactly like my brother. I'm so sorry. Now, God used that formula to tell us Moses didn't see the face. He saw my similitude, my semblance. He didn't really know who I really look like. God is a mathematician. You cannot form God in words. Amen? Now, let me show you all how this all ends. From the audible voice, you now get to physical and visible appearance. If you can't manage God's voice effectively, you can't see God's face. If you can't manage God's voice effectively, you can't see God's face. You can't manage God's voice effectively, you can't see God's face. Now let me give you a proof. Can I give you a proof? Can I give you a small proof before I close? Who wants that proof? Okay, John 1 verse 1. In the beginning was the word. Someone said, in the beginning. Come on, in the beginning was what? So you see where it all begins. The word. The word comes from who? Who brings a word? Who brings a word? God and a person. Am I right? So in the beginning was the word. That's the thing I'm asking. In the beginning of your revelation is the word. From God, for a person, the word. Now look at this. Genesis 12, verse 1. See how it began. Come on, quickly. Quickly, verse 1. Genesis. And now the Lord has said, somebody said, how did Abraham begin to meet with God? Word. Somebody said, word. The Lord had said, in the beginning was what? It was the word of God. So that's how God began Abraham in the journey to encounters. If God appeared to Abraham face to face and was enticed, he has to master the word and grow from the word to trance, to dream, to until then, full-blown encounter comes. Amen? Revelations. Encounters. Brought a man into the place where God used his mouth. Do you know who God is? Yeah? And called Abraham my friend. If I hear it now, I just drop dead. I want to go to heaven now with that chief testimony. Listen. When you get back home, you look at. So, Genesis 17, 1 is appearance. Genesis 18, 1 to 3 is an appearance. But this time, different dimensions of appearance. Appearance first for fraternity, for koinonia, for intimacy, then appearance for initiation into an order. Then when you go to 1 Samuel 3, 4 to 5, 10 to 11, 21, you see God first began to appear to Samuel by word. And he began to graduate. Then you get to 21, the Lord appeared to Samuel. Step by step. Isaiah, the same thing. Chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. God, Isaiah was busy learning how to get from persons, then to books, to videos, to DVDs, and then to trance. And when he got to chapter 6, the Lord fully came. Daniel chapter 9, 1 to 2, by books. By books. Get to Daniel chapter 10, verse 2 to 7, by vision, appearance. Now write this down, let's close. Blessings of divine encounter, blessings of God encounter, blessings. One, deeper light and revelation of God and the things of the Spirit. Deeper light and revelation of God and the things of the Spirit. When I have a God encounter, I have deeper light. I have revelations of God and the things. Of the Spirit. Psalm 119, verse 18. Open down my eyes, and I may be wondrous things out of thy word. Verse 10. 130. Thy word is a lamp. No, thy word, the entrance of thy word, give a light and give understanding unto the simple. Psalm 25, verse 14. You see that God now reveals his secrets because encounter has been established and relation established. He shows his covenants to some people. Secrets of some people. Number 2, divine direction and guidance. Psalm 32, verse 8. I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way that thou shalt go. I will guide thee with my eyes. I'll guide thee with my eye. You see, encounters bring direction. God guides you, directs you. Psalm 33, verse 1 to 4. You know it. The Lord my shepherd, I shall know what. He became a delight in deep pastures. He led me beside the still water, restored my soul. He led me beside them. So God is the one leading you now because he's your shepherd. He's in relationship with you. Isaiah 58, verse 11. The Lord shall guide thee continually. Continually. Then Proverbs 3, verse 6. Oh my God. In all thy ways, acknowledge him and he shall do what? Direct thy path. The Lord directs the path of those he reveals himself to. Number 1, 3, impartation of faith for great feats and accomplishment. Impartation of faith for great feats and accomplishment. Impartation of faith for great feats and accomplishment. Feet, not F-I-T, not F-E-E-T, F-E-A-T, A-T-S, feats and accomplishment. You find that in 1 Samuel 17, 26, command 32. What shall we give to the man that kills us with the Philistine and then take the shame of Israel? They said the king will do this. Okay, let not your heart trouble thee. Thy servant shall go and fight that Philistine. Why? Boldness came because of his encounters with God. What others fear, he dared. When you see God, you know, everything, nothing else matters in sight. The day you see God, nothing else matters in him. You can tear any mountain and conquer it. Number next. So your encounter with God kills your fear, kills your little heart, kills your lily liver, kills your chicken heart, and it bears faith for miracle signs and wonders. Number four, in particular the fear of God. When I meet with God, his fear is renewed in my spirit. Psalm 111 verse 10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of what? But in Job 28:28, it is not the beginning, it actually is wisdom. The fear of the Lord, that is wisdom. That is wisdom. So in Psalm we learn it leads to it, but in Job it is that highway to wisdom. Then you jump, Proverbs 16:6, it says, those who fear the Lord, they depart from iniquity. By the fear of the Lord, men depart from iniquity. Then Proverbs 22 verse 4, read this for me. By fear of the Lord and humility is what brings. I'm telling you what the fear of the Lord, that his presence brings to you. What it gives you? It gives you one, riches and honor and life. It also gives you what? Purity of heart. It gives you dignity to flee from iniquity. What next? Impartation of divine nature. Impartation. You meet with him, you encounter him. It is easy to live like him, talk like him, walk like him. His purity is communicated. His royalty imparted. His dignity released to you. Every time you encounter God, you receive an impartation of the divine nature. 2 Peter 1 verse 4. That is purity of life is given to you. That is life of power is yours now. That is triumphant and victorious life becomes yours now. That is abundant, prosperous, successful life. The life of God becomes your God the more you mix with God. The day Jesus met with him in that mountain of transformation, his light began to shine like the body of God. Amen, somebody? Number 4-6, impartation of courage to fight to the end without giving up. Once you meet God, you can fight, you can take any insult. They can trample on your feet, you don't bother. Your wife can even do terrible things, you don't look at that. If not for the fact that I met God, what I would have done to you for now? It's not who I that live, but Christ that lives me. Yes or no? So you forgive something that mere mortals can't forgive because you have met him. Stand up and shout, hey! Say, I am blessed. Let us say, hey! I am blessed. Lift up to us. Lift it up. Come on, lift it up. Lift it up. Lift it up. Yes, you are. Let's go. Oh, yes, you are.